Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. My name is Kim Ricketts, and I manage the Research Visiting Speaker Series, so thank you for coming out here to the research area. Today, I'm very, very pleased to introduce Bill Moggridge to you. Digital touch and technology has changed the way we interact with everything, and designers of this technology no longer regard their job as designing just an object, but designing how we interact with it. When personal computers were first becoming popular, they were mostly used as professional tools or as games machines for teenagers. But today, writes Bill Moggridge, we need to design technology differently to make it a graceful part of our everyday life, like the other things we own, our clothes, the plates we eat off, the furniture we buy for our houses. We've come to a stage where computer technology needs to be designed as part of our everyday culture so that it's beautiful and intriguing and that it has emotive as well as functional qualities. Bill's new book, Designing Interactions, is a collection of interviews with 40 influential designers who have shaped our interactions with technology over the years. From Bill Wright to Larry Page to Doug Engelbart to many others, and their stories and graphics comprise, in this book, it's a history of this kind of design. Bill Moggridge is a founder of IDEO, one of the most successful design firms in the world, and an award-winning designer himself. In 1980, he designed the first laptop computer, the Grid Compass. He's been a visiting professor in interaction design at the Royal College of Art, a lecturer on design at the London Business School, and is currently professor of design at Stanford University. Please join me in welcoming Bill Moggridge to Microsoft Research.
Thank you. Hello, thank you very much. I wanted to start by telling you a story. I think that a lot of my research has been a sort of living history, and this is really a story about the desktop, the thing that we use on our PCs. I got the first part of this story from Tim Mott. Once upon a time, he was waiting for a friend in a bar, as a matter of fact. Tim is actually, was hired by Ginn, which is a subsidiary of Xerox, a publishing company in Boston in the mid-70s. They asked him to go to Park, to work with Park, to sort of do some user interface work on publishing software. For editors and such. And when he got to Park, he started to work on that and then extended that into the invention of the desktop. After that, he ran Versatech, which was another subsidiary of Xerox, then left to be one of the founders of Electronic Arts, and then founded Macromedia, now he's a venture capitalist. So. But this is what he said about the desktop.
I was hired by a publishing company that Xerox owned at the time to manage a project they were doing with Park to learn the system that was being built there, take it back to the publishing company, and have people at the publishing company use it. I wrote a letter of resignation and said, this is not a project that you should be doing, period. That letter found its way to Bob Taylor, who was running the computer science lab at the time. I sat down and spent some time with Bob, and he basically said, well, why don't you figure out what it is we should be doing? That was when I started working with Larry Tesla. The way we went about the design was to actually work with the editors at Ginn. I went back, I spent several weeks with them and put them in front of an imaginary display with a real keyboard and a real mouse, and asked them if they could sort of walk me through imagining using that hardware to edit. And once Larry and I hit on this idea of having people talk about how they would want to do the work they did today, but with a new set of tools, the design itself became pretty simple as well, because there was a methodology that came out of it. Somewhere in one of my notebooks in Xerox, there is a bar napkin with one of the first desktop metaphors. We had this very intuitive text editor, and we were working on what we thought was going to be a very intuitive page layout system, but we were still stumbling, all the users were still stumbling around things like filing and printing and deleting. As I was thinking about this, it just occurred to me that there was no reason why we couldn't use the same approach and build an environment that allowed people to move documents around in the same way that we were allowing them to move text around inside a document. And we didn't call it the desktop, we called it the office. We actually called it the office schematic, was the first name that it had. But it was very similar to the desktop metaphor that we see today.
So yes, that was actually a reconstruction. We couldn't, I did interview Stu Card, who's still at Xerox after all this time, but he couldn't find the relevant notebook. So I asked him to actually redo it and make a fax, send me a fax of what his best memory of his original sketch on the napkin was, and then we drew it in front of the camera there as a reconstruction, not unfortunately the original. One of the best interviews I had was with Larry Tesler, because he just has such an incredible sequence of events, and if you're trying to do a living history, he really has got a lot of story to tell, because he was at Stanford first, then he was at Park, and then he was at Apple. So he sort of bridged across those worlds in the creation of what we think of as our desktop. And so here he is talking.
We got in this pattern, Bill and I, where he worked nights and I worked days. And we overlapped morning and night. Tim Mott and I did the same thing. We worked 14-hour shifts, Tim and I, overlapping by an hour both ends, so we could tell the other guy what we'd done. We shared one Alta between us. So I'd work for, 12 hours, and he'd show up. I'd tell him what I had done, and then he would just pick up the code I was doing. He could work on the code another 12 hours. Then I'd come in, and he'd show me what he had done, and we'd brainstorm user interface, and then continue. And we did that for days on end to get the thing working. With Bill, I would run user tests all day. It was easy to find subjects. Every new Apple employee had never used a computer before. Well, not all day, but I'd run 3 or 4 tests during the day on whatever Bill had given me the night before. Then I'd give him a report at the end of the day and say, here's what I learned today, why don't you try this, why don't you try that, and we would talk about ideas, and then he'd go off and go home and spend the night programming and come in the morning with a new version for me, and then go home and go to bed. And that's how we developed the first Lisa user interface specification. There was a dominance of people from HP working on the Lisa team. They had already gone to putting a row of buttons at the bottom of every window, so it was a big menu tree that you had to sort of keep in your head, and you'd have to walk down and go like edit, insert, you know, that sort of thing, and walk down the hierarchy. Anyway, I thought this was just horrible mode. That was the interface. No, guys. People can't keep all these menu hierarchies in their heads, and everything needs to be apparent. So one day I said to Bill, Bill, why don't you try something different? Why don't you try moving it to the top of the screen? So he went home, and he came in the next day, went directly to Steve Jobs' office to show him first, I think, and then came over to us to show us. And in one night, he had developed the entire pull-down menu system, everything. I mean, he hadn't just moved it to the top of the screen, which was what I'd suggested. He had gotten the idea of as you scan your mouse across the top, each menu would pop up, you know, without you having to, like, you know, click each one, which is what was in my head. And they would ruffle, you know, as you went back and forth and appear, so you could scan them all. I went, oh, right, this is what we want. We want everything to be apparent. He'd come up with highlighting them as you moved your mouse back down inside them, command shortcuts. He thought up the whole thing in one night. It was, I can't imagine what happened that night.
So, you know, I think it's a little bit confusing in the sense that that was such a big aha that one can sort of get the misinformed idea that it was all possible in one night. But it was only an iteration that was possible because they'd been doing this week after week on a 24-hour cycle, and also because they had these years and years of experience. So I think, you know, the sort of aha that you get in design when something suddenly comes right is only going to be possible when it is something which you are building on something you've already had. So the idea of rapid prototype and test with people is a recurring theme, But those guys have been doing that in a cyclical way, in such an intense way, for over a 24-hour cycle, as Larry said about working with Tim Mott as well. So it's not just doing it out of the blue. It's doing it after a lot of work to build up towards it. The great thing about Bill Atkinson was that he took a lot of Polaroids of his work on those prototypes. And each screen that he developed when he was working on the Lisa software, he took Polaroids of it. And I was able to publish 28 of those in the book at actual size, so you can see them. But here he is talking a little bit more about that process.
My first major work that I did for Apple was porting over the UCSD Pascal system to the Apple II. And when I hired on, they hired me as the application software department. They saw software sort of as a necessary evil to sell the box, which is really what they were building. Then after that, I became the graphics and user interface lead on the Lisa team. So for that, I wrote the what later became the QuickDraw graphics routines that all the applications use. And I got to design a lot of user interface stuff. What I've got here is a binder of some Polaroids that I took. These are just mock-ups. These aren't finished product. This is a prototype that I did showing people about choosing a tool first. And so that was our first tool palette. Choose a rectangle tool. Now when I draw, I'm laying out a rectangle. And when I let go, nothing changes. It's already there. Here was a notion of a folder with a menu at the bottom of it. That didn't work so well. Problem is the window might be narrow and you couldn't see them all. Here was the first of the pull-down menus. Now, the advantage of putting the menus at the top is you had the whole height to deal with, and you had always the full width, regardless which window was using that. You got a second benefit, which is you started a kinesthetic feel of where that item was, that it's, oh, it's over here someplace. And so you could actually start reaching for it before you even thought about it. And that's one of the reasons that the pull-down menus were such a success. The width of the title is much less than the width of the menu. So as you slide across here and these flap out, it feels like they're all here, but really they're all grossly overlapped because there's a lot more area. You're getting a lot more area out of it than you really have. I think that the way that user interfaces get better is by the designers watching people trying to use them. And it's very humbling. I remember when we were working on the Lisa user interface, we'd have a half-silvered mirror between two rooms. And what we would do with each piece of software we were working on, we would hand it to them and say, well, here's the task. And ask them not only to try to accomplish the task, but to give us a stream of consciousness. Tell me what you're thinking about as you do it. Sort of mumble to yourself. And many times we discovered things from that we would not have discovered without that.
So I think it's interesting to compare Lisa to Mac because, you know, Lisa was the project that really was about an interface to use at work. So it was more like the star and more like a precursor for Windows, really. It was a team that worked for a long time. They ran over budget. They ran over time. But they did some incredibly innovative work. And then they took the result of that and applied it to the Mac, which they thought of as being for a 14-year-old boy. So that was, in a way, the first consumer version of a PC. Let me leap forward here, though, and show you a couple of little exercises in screen graphics that I was involved with myself, with Philip Joe, who's sitting over here. He was working with me in San Francisco in 1988. We'd just done some work for Claris, the spin-out, software spin-out from Apple, on MacWrite 2, and they asked us to talk about the future of user interfaces in a slightly more general sense, a sort of concept project. And this was showing the idea of a transparent window structure, which I think reminds me somewhat of Vista. And you can see there the difference between a little segment on the left there is a pixel on-off, and then full color on the right. And then this version is using grayscale instead of pixel on-off. And you can see how close that gets to the color, actually. It's amazing how grayscale is quite nice to look at. And then we had another little exercise there, which was adding the idea of a flying menu. So you have a sort of drop shadow effect allowing your menus to be ripped off and floating in the center of the screen. Both, all those ideas seemed to, you know, sort of, they were quite innovative at the time in 1988, but they were more commonplace now. Then let's leap forward to System 10. Cordell Ratzlaff actually designed the Mac OSs from 8.5 through 10. Then he left to a dot-com startup company, which was successful, a travel agency. Then he joined Frog in San Francisco and was head of interaction design there. And he's just left to go to Cisco as their lead for design. But here he's talking a little bit about some of the use of transparency in System 10.
The big difference with Mac OS X was that was completely design-driven. We focused on what we thought people would want and what they would need and how they would interact with the products. We made sure we got that right. And then we went and saw and tried to determine how you achieve that technically. We had this idea of a time-based operating system where we were using not only the two dimensions that you have on the screen, but a third dimension of time. One of the criticisms that people had about the Mac OS ever since the beginning was dragging a disk icon to the trash to eject it. That was something that we knew confused new users, because normally if you had a file that you wanted to delete, you would drag it to the trash and it would be gone. And now we're asking people to do the same thing with this very valuable disk where they've got all their information on. You make the same gesture, and rather than deleting it, it just ejects it out of the computer. We did something very simple that solved that in Mac OS X, and that was just based on time and what you're doing at the time, or when you select an object that can be ejected, the trash can actually changes to an eject button. A second way we used animation in the interface was to provide hints for where an object is going and where it came from. And you see that in the dock when you minimize a window. The window will morph into the place where it rests in the dock. When you restore that window, it comes out of the dock in the same way. So if I really want to have 100 things in my dock, I can do that. The trade-off I have is that things, you know, it gets harder and harder to see them. So we thought it was much better to let our users make that decision than for us to try and impose something on them. But we also came up with an idea to address that. So as your dock gets smaller and smaller and smaller, it becomes harder and harder to differentiate between the different things in the dock. So we came up with a way for, as you roll over items in the dock, they can magnify. On the visual side, where things were dark and gloomy and square and beveled, we wanted to make them light and fun and fresh and colorful. And when there was where there was something that was square, we wanted to make it round. And we wanted to, where there was something that was just kind of chunky, we wanted to give it a very fluid expression. Some of the designers had magazine ads for liquor. They typically have a glass with ice cubes in it. And if you look in there, you see all these great specular reflections and highlights. And that's actually where we drew a lot of the inspiration from.
So that was a little sequential story, which is more of a historical nature. The book that I've been working on for the past few years is, the first third of it is more the sort of history things. It's the stories about how things started. And it's wonderful to have a subject where everybody's alive, you know. It's a living history because it's such a young subject, and nobody's dead yet. Doug Engelbart's my oldest interviewee, and he's still very lively. And then the middle section is more by subject matter, so it's like sort of a bit on service design, a bit on the internet, and so on. And then the last bit is more conjectural, with a how-to chapter at the end, which is more process-oriented. I wanted to do this because I thought of myself as a designer for the first third of my career, roughly. And then in the middle bit, I thought of myself more as somebody who helped other people design, more design management as IDEO started to get bigger. But now that we've got wonderful younger people in charge of looking after the company and running it, I don't have those responsibilities. So I decided I'd like to tell stories about design. And this is my first attempt to tell some stories. But I'm interested in, you know, different media. I think books are wonderful, and to be able to have images on the page and the resolution of paper, and the sense of smell when you read a book, that's great. But also I think video is wonderful, and having a chance to do those interviews on film and then edit them so that you can get a sense of the individual that's talking in a way that you can't on the written word. Also, you can see the interactive examples more easily when you use them as an illustration of the talking head. So I did the DVD that goes in the back of the book. I also did a website so that you can browse a lot of the content on the web, designinginteractions.com, and to make sure that people could access the material if they didn't have the money. And we've got a download chapter of the week. See the bar across the bottom there? So if you wait 12 weeks, you can download the whole of the material, both the PDFs of the chapters and the quick times of the videos. Of course, if you did that, you'd spend more on, you know, you wanted then to print it out, you'd spend more on paper and ink than if you bought the book. And then on the website there's a tab which is about the chapters, and you can click on each of the chapters. And on the interview tab, you can go directly to any of those interviews and see a small version of the QuickTime, a postage stamp size, playing real time online, as well as being able to download the higher resolution version. And I thought I'd click on Bill Verplank for you. When I was trying to work out what interaction design could be in the early 80s, he joined me from Xerox and was very influential at ID2, as we were then, in deciding what kind of work we thought we could contribute. He also draws beautifully, so as my first prototype for this book in 2001, I had him come and do the first interview, and I put three cameras so we could see him draw, see his face, and see his full body. So here is a little segment where he's talking about the nature of interaction design.
I'm going to start with the definition of interaction design. Focusing on design for people. So that's a person interacting, acting on the world, and getting feedback from the world. The interaction designer has three questions to answer. They're all how do you questions. The first question is how do you do? How do you affect the world? And I think of a simple choice there between handles and buttons. So I can deal with the world by pushing buttons, or I can grab a hold of the world and manipulate it, or grab a hold of a product and turn it or twist it. This is the handle world. That's the world of continuous control. The buttons are the world of discrete control. The second question is how do you feel? This is how do we get feedback from the world. There I like McLuhan's distinction between what he called fuzzy or cool media and hot or distinct. Cool and hot. Early television was a cool medium with its fuzzy images. A book with careful printing or a gravestone with a carved type is hot. It's immutable. You cannot touch it or change it. Cool media draw you in. This is the handle and the button. Finally, the third question is how do you know? And as we design interactions with computers in them, it's very difficult for the user of those products to know exactly what they're going to do. And a nice dichotomy is deciding whether the user needs a map to see an overview of how everything works. Or maybe the user just needs to know exactly what to do moment to moment, and a path is sufficient. Do this, do this, do this, do this. So those are the three basic things that happen in an interaction. A human, a person we're designing for, does something, and we provide affordances. As designers, we design the way that the machine gives feedback. Finally, it's the question of what kind of knowledge do we expect of our users? Can we design good maps for them to hold in their heads? Can we design the emergency procedures step by step, how to do things? So that's the first definition of what it is we design as interaction designers.
So chapter two, about the PC, what was one where Cordell Ratzlaff was included, but I wanted to show you the story of the Microsoft mouse. And this was actually pretty important for me personally and us at IDEO, because it was the first example where all the three companies that came together to form IDEO worked together. So I worked on the interaction design and human factors with Bill Verplank and Jane Fulton doing the testing. The industrial design was done by Matrix Product Design, and then the engineering was done by David Kelly Design. So those are the three companies that actually came together to form IDEO in 1991. And the industrial design is talked about here by Paul Bradley, who's still at IDEO with us, an industrial designer. He describes the process. But we're very grateful to Microsoft for giving us that opportunity to try each other out.
When Microsoft approached us on the project, it became clear in the early conversations that it wasn't kind of the typical just design us a mouse and get it on the market, but they wanted to design the end-all mouse, essentially the mouse that was going to be better than anything that preceded it. Quick model making was a key. I think we probably built, you know, 70, 80, 90, 100 different foam models quickly. The first step was looking broadly to make sure that we were exploring all the possibilities of what a mouse could be. So going out and talking to users about how they use their mouse, observing them, watching them, kind of looking at the nuances of computing, led us to you know, certain beliefs that then we built prototypes of and tested. We thought by building small mice that were symmetrical, so say a small round mouse, that you could actually capture the mouse in your fingertips like you capture a pen in your fingertips and create a higher degree of accuracy. We were very surprised when we went off and did testing with prototypes against other mice, tests like tapping tests and maze tests and a variety of tests that Bill Verplank actually had set up and Jane Fulton, that although they felt more accurate, they failed in, you know, 70% of the tests to perform better than a more traditional elongated mouse. And what we discovered was that having the mouse kind of fully encompassed in your hand gave you more control over it. Even though the sense was that your fingertips would give you control, it was the hand and then the resting posture of the rest of your arm on the table that actually allowed you to perform more accurate and quicker accuracy tests. Moving the ball forward on the mouse was the biggest change that we made. Mice had been driven from a manufacturing point of view, kind of coming from the PC world, so it looks like a PC, coming from a world where we need to be able to make this cheap. And the cheap way to make the mouse is with the ball in the back. And watching the motion of people's arms and the observations, realized that moving the ball forward would allow you to basically have a shorter motion to accomplish a fuller motion up on the screen. If you look at a mouse today on your desktop, most of them have the ball, although maybe not always to the front, but forward of center. And that's become kind of the standard for mice.
So the mouse was actually initially manufactured by Alps in Japan. So typical of the industrial designer, Paul was off there having fun learning karaoke in Japan, whereas we were slaving away doing the testing. The third chapter follows the sequence of the movement from desktop to laptop and then down to Palm. But I thought the example that you might be interested in seeing is Bert Keeley, because he's definitely the most advanced in terms of interaction design in that sequence. And he's talking about the use of the new tablet.
The essence of what I'm trying to bring to the personal computer, you should probably think of it as a tablet mode, and that is a mode in which you can hold it in one hand, use it with the other, and do the interacting with just one hand. And the pen clearly is the precise and most exciting tool with which to do that in the current generation of tablet PCs. That tablet mode allows you to be more mobile because you can interact entirely with one hand. So do something else with one hand, use the PC with one hand. The combining graphical sketches with textual capture is really something that you can only do with the pen. Very difficult to do all that with a voice, impossible to do it with just a keyboard, and difficult to do it with a combination of keyboard and mouse. That said, just the ability to literally capture your thoughts and see them the way that you thought them, essentially, that's the first layer. The second layer is to be able to transform those into other data types. And the most obvious example, the one that everybody thinks of as the gating factor with regards to tablet computers, is text, is ink to text, and the ability to essentially of the system to recognize your handwriting and translate it into ASCII or you know whatever text format you want it in. Something that you only find out when you're using a pen as a text input device and also using it as a pointing device is that the interleaving of pointing and writing happens so fast that you really are able to compose as quickly with a pen as you can with a keyboard. And this isn't a function of handwriting recognition being as an equal number of words per minute. This is a function of handwriting recognition plus correction plus pointing plus, you know, placing your cursor, selecting, dragging text around, reformatting, undoing. You've got all this combination of things that you're trying to do, some of which is text input and some of which is pointing device. And when you can do that in a fraction of a second back and forth between the activities, it's really astounding.
So I think that probably is the thing that beats the mouse, you know, in terms of an alternative input device which is integrated into the interactions. And perhaps we'll see a lot more of it as time moves on. Adopting technology, you can see this photograph here of somebody being helpful to a visitor, you know, actually wrapping the two remotes in paper to only reveal the buttons you actually need, and then labeling them clearly in handwriting. What kindness, but how sad that that's necessary. I found that the words of David Liddell, when I interviewed him, were very useful for me in terms of thinking about this process of adoption. He talks about there being three phases in terms of any technology. I mean, it could be the motor car or cameras or anything with electronic technology as well. But he talks about three phases of the enthusiast phase, the professional, and the consumer. And that generally, when a new technology arrives, the enthusiasts sort of grab it, and they're so happy that it's there that, of course, they don't care whether it's difficult to use. In fact, they rather love it. I mean, the early motor cars, you know, they take them out on Sunday afternoon. You want them to break down twice, so you have the pleasure of fixing them before you go home. British motor cars still do the same, but... then somebody realizes that that technology could be useful for work, and then, you know, there becomes a price point, and people start using it in terms of making themselves more productive. And I think that's probably a lot of Microsoft's history. If you look at the way that products are developed here, they are mostly thought of as being useful for work, at least until recently. And there again, you don't really worry too much about whether it's easy to use, because we all take pride in learning something that makes us feel expert for our work. And the products are bought by people who are buying in terms of features and productivity, so that the business actually succeeds if it's got those features and it's obviously helping with productivity without really having to worry about being easy to learn or enjoyable immediately until the expertise is gained. And it's only when it's been successful normally in that work cycle that it moves into the consumer phase, when the price point comes down and people want to use it in their everyday life. And then it suddenly matters very much that it's enjoyable and easy to use. Interestingly, you can leap straight across with things like games, because they go straight into the consumer phase with no development through the other two phases. But I found that actually quite an interesting way of kind of analyzing the nature of products. And thinking, well, of course, the Mac was consumer phase right at the beginning, whereas Lisa wasn't at all. And similarly, if I think about many of the Microsoft products, like Microsoft Word, for example, I think of that as being something that's really a work-based product. And so that explains a lot about its attributes. One of the people I interviewed in this adopting technology story was Paul Mercer. He did the chipsets for the iPod, but he left Apple having worked on Newton and a few other things when he was there, and left Apple before he did those chipsets. He tells the story about why the iPod has been so successful so far.
If you look at the culture of Apple, it is a company that's had 25 years of building personal products, and in the last few years they've had a very, very astute individual at the top that can really dictate in many ways or arbitrate what's good and not good. That culture, that management capability that's at Apple makes it unique in this industry. You know, I think to answer the question of why the iPod is so great compared to the competition, if you break it down, they started very slowly and they built it up over the years. They started by acquiring the technology. They acquired a company called SoundJam to build iTunes. And this was back in, I think, 99, 2000 or so. And they turned that into the iTunes franchise, starting first on the Macintosh. The ability to generate the music, to let the user rip that music. How do you get that content at the beginning? That's the root of the problem. You've got to have it. So Apple invested in iTunes and built that up and improved it over the years. In 2001, Apple shipped the first device that synchronized with iTunes. The two were deeply integrated together. Now keep in mind, the iPod is very simple-minded in terms of at least what the device does. It's very smooth in what it does, but the screen is very low resolution. It really doesn't do much other than let you navigate your music. The simplification that went into the design of it was very well thought through. And the capability to build it is not commoditized. It's very curious, right? Because the iPod's been out there. It's been essentially unchanged in terms of its core software design and user interface design has remained unchanged for about 3 years now. And then in 2003, Apple launched the iTunes Music Store. And this, again, was something that did not exist at a level that was mass marketable. Apple was the first to make it mass market capable. They applied that Apple magic to make that possible. They took their time in doing that. It took Apple a couple of extra years before iTunes for Windows was actually developed and shipped. And so again, they're practically moving in slow motion, really, if you look at it in hindsight. But the industry has not been able to match it. And so now today, Apple's moving into color displays and eventually they'll move into video as Moore's Law continues, giving us its bounty.
Yeah, I think the interesting lesson there is that a lot of people think of iPods as being successful because of that physical design, the products. But of course, it is a system question. I mean, the story is very clear there that iTunes came first, and that took a long time to be positioned against Napster and so on before it became iTunes Music Store. And then it was only after that that the products themselves became advantageous. So you put those together. They all have to be well designed. They all have to have a good culture of innovation, and they have to have strong leadership. But it's only the system that really makes it successful. Here's a little concept project that we did with Motorola recently, which looks at the sort of future of things that are more in the wearable computer zone, which are more a mixture of watch, TV, PDA kind of thing.
The work that I do, it requires that I'm tapped in at all times. I run with a pretty see and be seen kind of crowd, and they have the latest of everything. Always. My bracelet is my lifeline in a lot of ways. It keeps me informed, it keeps me connected, and lets me know what's going on in today's world. I've always been really animated with my hands, and Moto gives me a chance to use that to my advantage. And people take notice of that, and that is the name of the game. It's much more human. And there's something very alluring about that. I interact with this differently than any other technology that's out there. J- just last week I was styling Nora Jones, and I heard that she loved this boutique in Chicago that's called Ikram. So I contacted my assistants in the morning and to find out if anybody had any time to go and get a rack of clothes and ship them overnight. Within 1 minute, someone was on it, and within 5 minutes, they were sending me images from the boutique. It was done. Done. That's one of the best words in the business. I show up to this party with my limited edition Issei Moto animation, and I'll tell you, it didn't go unnoticed. I mean, it was a little pricey, but I had to have it, and for the reactions that I got, it was worth every cent. This season's image collection came in this beautiful box with an explanation of what inspired the design, and it even had a little note from Issei himself. That was such a nice touch. The technology catering to someone like me is so important, and I can't imagine that it wouldn't be important to someone like you. I think that we've just been trained to believe otherwise, that what's out there is out there, and that's what we have to accept. That's not the case anymore. We no longer have to conform to that technology. It's going to work with us now, and that is a godsend.
So notice the prototyping techniques there. There's a storytelling, there's a little video, there's a simple model, and a lot of After Effects to make the animations look as if they're fairly real. So a lot of smoke and mirrors. You know, I think we have a lot to learn from play just because of that idea of going straight to the consumer phase, that this, the evolution through the enthusiast and professional phase doesn't exist in games. And Will Wright, the creator of this series of The Sims, is very articulate about that. And he talks about the speed of learning in acquisition that is necessary if you're going to have a successful game.
As a kid, I spent far too much of my time making models, you know, little aircraft, tanks. When the first personal computers came out, and around 1980, I bought one of the first Apple IIs, but I got totally sucked into the software side of it, especially simulations, the idea that you could build this, you know, virtual model inside the computer, and not only was it kind of a, you know, a model of the static structure, but it was also a model of the process. At that point, I just kind of decided, you know, that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to learn to build these models, and that's when I started pursuing it as a career and kind of went from there into the game industry. The Sims has reached a level of success that is just amazing. At some point, I think we realized that it was like the best-selling PC game in history now. And a lot of that really is, I think, related to the community design around The Sims. You know, the game itself was interesting and compelling, but the community that built up around The Sims really is what brought it to the level of success that it currently has. Well, actually, The Sims probably has more sex than most games out there. I mean, it's PG sex, and it's more, you know, kind of titillation than realization. You know, The Sims is basically in a social space, and it's about the way these people relate. And they can get married, and they can have kids. They can go hang out in the hot tub together. They can play in bed. So when I first play a game, the very first thing I'm dealing with is a five-second kind of feedback loop between the computer and the player. And that's usually the control structure. So the controls have to be understandable, and it's actually got to be fun to kind of use the controls. With a game like The Sims, the very first level is, you know, how do I make my character move around and interact with objects? And you learn that, oh, I click on an object and it comes up with a menu and I select an item. Then, once you know that, once you can move your character around and interact with objects, you start noticing that they have needs, that they'll, you know, they need to go to the bathroom, they need to eat, they need to have social interaction with other characters. Each one of those has a failure state. If they don't eat, they'll starve to death. If they don't go to the bathroom, they'll soil the carpet. So then, you know, at that point you start learning to keep all of their needs in the green. Once you've learned that, you've actually bought some free time that you can then start pursuing the economics of the game. So every game has kind of this these overlapping loops of interaction. I'm compressing a large set of possibilities down into a few algorithms of computer code. When I hand you the computer code and you start running it, you can then decompress it in your play experience to this rich set of possibilities.
So Spore, of course, is his new biological equivalent of The Sims, which he's launched recently, but he wasn't working on that at the time that he did the interview, I don't think. I think services are an interesting new design challenge. If we think about a telephone service, for example, if you think of the old telephones like that, you know, you picked it up and put it on your ear and then you dialed the thing and you got through to another human. You said, well, I'd like to speak to Mrs. Smith in Shady Dell. And the operator would say, is it the Mrs. Smith in Cedar Street or Main Street? It was a human-to-human interaction. And there really was, the technology infrastructure is so simple that you really didn't think of it as a design problem. People thought of it as a training problem. So they take the operators and they teach them to handle it when the customers were rude or know what to say in different circumstances. But the actual connection was a very simple jack plug kind of operation. Compare that with your cell phone today. And now it's all technology in the way. And it's not human. It's human to technology and technology to human. And therefore, it becomes a design problem. And there are lots of different modes. I mean, the question of going through your address book with a limited keyboard is in itself a challenge. And then the idea of actually reaching the internet and doing things with sophisticated access to websites as well as regular telephone calls becomes another huge challenge. In fact, if you think of it as a design problem, it's sort of horrifying because you've got this very sophisticated, complicated physical object which is very intimate, like a wine glass. You hold it up to your face and you hold it in your hand and it in itself is a big design problem. It's then got all this technology inside it, so it's tremendously demanding in terms of engineering with batteries and circuit boards and everything. Then it's got the screen, you know, the interaction design problem of the usual user interaction of a screen and input device, but the screen is small and the input device is primitive. And then you have the service design on top of that. And on top of that, you have all these websites, which are designed for big screens and regular input devices, and they're not usually designed to be scaled successfully to that small screen. What's more, all this is done in the wrong time scale, because the thing that takes longest is the telephone. So you can't really alter the service based on the telephone, because the telephones take 3 years or 2 years to develop. The service is probably only going to take 3 months to develop. So it's a very difficult state of affairs. I was struck by the fact that the iMode service in Japan was the most successful telephone service to use the internet on cell phones. And I thought it'd be interesting to research why that was so successful. They went from 1 to 33 million subscribers in 3 years in a population of only 160 million. And it turned out that there was a sort of spin-out within NTT Docomo, which was started by Inoki-san on the top right there. They hired in Mari Matsunaga, who came from an advertising magazine background, doing small ads with very short sentences describing things very clearly for her messaging expertise. And she wrote this really nice book about developing the design. And then I went to Tokyo to try and meet the other big player, Takeshi Natsuno, who was the entrepreneur that they had in their group, who was developing the point of view about designing for the internet. And here's what he says.
I joined NTT Docomo 5 years ago to launch this service. Now I have more than 32 million subscribers, and I also have more than 12 million Java phone users. The toughest thing I had to overcome was how to migrate internet way of thinking with this legacy telecom way of thinking. Handset can represent your taste. That's why, you know, we are always making a really heavy effort for the tiny detail and also the shape, how round it should be. It's very important. To keep antenna, sometimes very important because in the lifestyle, some people using like this. We have to coordinate all the value chain from the handset to the content. Because to have this kind of, you know, software here means you have to have a content provider for this. You have to have a network service to support this. And finally, to have great design phones is very important. User interface of the phones should be easy enough for everybody. We requested our handset vendors to have iMode button to launch iMode service, and also four direction keys like this. We developed more than 180 icons. Each icon shows some messages like heart mark always shows you some kind of love messages. When I first introduced iMode phones, the capability was just to browse the web and to send and get receiving emails. With the second generation, you started to download color graphics, you started to download ringtone from the network to the phone. And with third generation iMode phones, thanks to Java capability, you can customize the function of the phone. So some people customized their phone as a karaoke machine. So to see the script here and to sing a song, practice.
So Takashi was very clever, I think, about choosing a few applications early in the process which would really be appropriate for his user group. For example, train timetables in Japan, online banking, the equivalent of the entertainment guide for what's on at the cinema. And those were websites where he talked to the website providers and got them to do a scaled version which would really work on the cell phone, and very successfully. However, once it got bigger and more people were starting to provide the service, then the control of the scalability was not really always quite so successful. And I don't really believe that story he tells about karaoke. I mean, who would really practice their karaoke on a cell phone? One of the things that happened was that our Tokyo office, the people there, about 6 months before I actually did this interview, had gone to do an observation of trying to use this same iMode service to buy a soft drink at a vending machine on a cold November day.
ありがとうございます。超ね。
So I don't think the people who designed that website at Coca-Cola did much in the way of prototyping and testing with users, do you? It was interesting, actually, because we were asked to do a version of this similar software for AT&T when they wanted to import it to the United States. And of course, the first thing you find out is that people use cell phones in almost a diametrically opposite way. Because in Japan, you have these long train commutes, and it's rude to talk. So you can't use the voice aspect of your phone. But you have tons of time to do stuff with your thumbs. Whereas in America, we commute in our cars, and we can't use our thumbs at all, but we can yell as loud as we like. So an approach had to be almost diametrically opposite in terms of the way the interaction design philosophy was tackled. So the internet, of course, is worthy of about several thousand books on its own. I mean, it's such a huge subject. I did actually go and interview the Google boys before they were really all that well known. It was in 2002. They still felt a little bit more as if they were out of Stanford than as if they were running a huge company. When they came to the interview at the office we have in Palo Alto, Larry turned up pretty much on time in normal-looking clothes, and Sergey turned up about 20 minutes late on his rollerblades in a crumpled T-shirt. Here they are.
We said, oh, we should just go out and start a company. And we developed this thing called PageRank, which lets you determine the importance of pages based on the links to them. You start with a web page. Actually, we used to start with my homepage. And you just follow the links. So it's like you're surfing, but you just follow the links from that page. And you keep doing that until you have the whole web.
You record everything as you go. And you do it at a rate much faster than a person would, you know, like 1,000 web pages per second or something.
Since we started in 98, we started with about 30 million web pages, which was a good number. You know, that's a lot more than you can read, right, in your lifetime. Now we have over 3 billion items. Just in the last, you know, a little over 3 years, we've increased by a size of a factor of 100. And those things, you know, require work. They require smart people, lots of computers, and all sorts of things.
When you look at our usage, we went from 10,000 searches per day, just as we just came out of Stanford and started the company, to over 100 million now. So that's a factor of 10,000. I designed the page, and, you know, I wasn't, you know, about to spend a lot of time on it, so I just put a search box in there and the search button and the logo, and that was it. Eventually, we added a little bit of stuff about the company, but it was still quite small and compact. And we realized how powerful that was, because it actually matters when you go to the homepage of a search engine. You know, you don't want to spend a lot of time trying to find the search box. You really want people to come there and then be able to right away use it for what they want. And after that, we made a conscious decision that we were going to, in fact, take things off that page.
So we've added a lot of services. It's a design challenge to add services without increasing the complexity.
In our case, we really insist on initially deploying a new service like we did with images. We will deploy them maybe off the advanced search page. And we insist that they get a lot of traction on their own, sort of without the benefit of that top page promotion. And if they have user pickup at that level, then we will go ahead and bring them up as a shortcut, a convenience to users.
We like to say we're focused on the ultimate search engine. And the ultimate search engine would basically understand everything on the web. It would understand exactly what you wanted. It would give you the right thing or the right things.
I think you have to, Sergey makes light of the design there, saying, oh, I just threw it together. But you have to remember that at that time, the dot-com madness was in full spate. And everybody else was doing these really busy flashing banner ad interfaces, which were terribly difficult to look at. So the fact that they were so careful about keeping it simple was more than just a haphazard choice, I think. Terry Winograd was actually their teacher, professor at Stanford, in the Gates building there. And he, since then, has done a little bit of a sabbatical where he's been at Google as they've kind of grown up a bit. And he said the biggest thing that he noticed was that it was so much easier with online stuff to do the user testing. for Terry, you know, to get 45 subjects to come in and test a design is a big effort. Whereas at Google, they could throw up a design they were talking about and have a million responses in a couple of days. So the idea of getting feedback from users is suddenly much more possible and easy. Another thing that Terry said, which I also felt I learned a lot from, was the sort of basic metaphors that we use in terms of design of interactions. And he talked about conversation as being the first metaphor historically, in the sense that in the old days, you know, you typed your teletype and it then sent a message into the mainframe did something, sent a message back. So that was a dialogue. And that was probably the root of the AI idea. Although, of course, the assumption that there would be a human intelligence there was always a disastrous one, so far at any rate. And then we moved to manipulation interfaces, which is everything about the PC, the way we use screens with drag and drop and direct manipulation. But when the web came along, suddenly people stopped talking about opening a file as they do on their PC, and they started talking about going to a website. So they were moving from a manipulation interface to a locomotion one. And now you see that there are pages all over the world which people say they go to and visit. Of course, the geography is not a physical one, but it's a web-based one. But it's the idea of actually going somewhere and seeing something. And in the era where the web was mostly read-only, that seemed a very spectacularly appropriate metaphor. However, I do see that the future will change that, in that as the web gets smarter, when we go to a site, we'll be able to do things. So I think we'll sort of start seeing a convergence of all those three metaphors in the future, that we'll go to a site, then we'll be able to do things, we'll be able to manipulate, and then we'll also have conversations with other people, potentially in a community. So the three things will perhaps come together again. So I think a common denominator that I found in terms of all these interviews that I did was this idea of the success of people and prototypes, particularly rapid prototypes. And this was very reassuring to me, because it's pretty much what we've evolved gradually over time at IDEO. And so in the last chapter, I just sort of described the people and prototypes approach in a little bit more detail, with some help from Duane Bray and Jane Fulton on those two subjects, although I didn't put a video interview in. You can read in the chapter pretty much what they said. And just as a reminder of those ideas, very shortly, I think as designers, we're often guilty of designing for ourselves rather than for the people who might use the product that we're working on, who might be younger or older, or teenagers and rebellious, or from some different background or some special role. And so the methods deck, which Jane and her human factors folks have evolved over the years, is 51 ways of researching what people really might need and want, but in the context of something you haven't designed yet. And I think that's a really important element of it. If you look at this chart, think of the stuff that's on the right, the latent opportunities and needs, is what those 51 methods are about. And that's the kind of research into people that you need to do before you've designed something, when it's not yet been invented. Whereas once you've got an idea, and that might happen after the first prototype, then you can test it in ways that are more like conventional market research, the left-hand half of that diagram. And that allows you to build a business case and figure out how much something might cost and sell for, how many people might like it. So I think those two sets of research techniques about people are very complementary but different from each other. And then in prototypes, if we're working on screen graphics, we expect to be using Macromind or Flash or something to do prototypes. And physical objects, it might be more the physical shop, like the one on the left there, or the lab if you're doing some electronic lash-ups. But I think the more experiential type of thing, the storytelling, the more complicated the scenario becomes, the more relevant it is to use techniques that are about stories and enactments. So things like video or After Effects or computer-based simulations become very relevant. But most important of all in my mind is the idea of very rapid prototyping, because I think it's only that way that design can get the trust of business. And if you say, well, a designer usually goes to their boss or their client and says, I have this great idea. It's going to be something you've never seen before. Give me a budget and trust me. And the business guy, who's been trained to avoid risk, says, never seen before? Oh dear, I can't trust that. What are the numbers about it? So the whole idea of being a business person is diametrically opposed to the idea of being a creative innovator. Or they know they need innovation, but they also know that they can't stand it when it comes. So what you can do, therefore, is give them a little innovation. The idea of a rapid prototype, which shows them something that's a small amount of effort, a small change. You can try something quickly, inexpensively, and then build trust that you can get the loop, the cycle, to move forward. So quick, rough techniques like trying a pull-down menu with a little bit of paper, or telling a story with a photograph on the beach, all those sort of quick techniques for prototyping, I think, are particularly important to make design successful. I did put a sort of circular, cyclical process diagram there, and in the book you will see a description of each of those elements in the wheel. But I also put there a central example of something which is a real project. And it shows you that in practice you don't really need to follow that cyclical pattern if it's more practical to jump about. And I think of the real process that we need as being much more like a pinball machine than a wheel, if we want to choose the things that will get us to the result as quickly as possible. Thanks. Yeah.
So John Maida has his book, Simplicity, and then today Mr. Norman said complexity is where it's at. Where do you weigh in on this?
I have got John Maida interviewed in my book, and I love his ideas of simplicity, and certainly I would like to follow that. I like Don's notions of emotional design as well. I'm not so sure about the complexity. Yeah.
Do you have a favorite Microsoft product?
I think the tablet PC is the one I'm sort of very interested in. I mean, of course, one uses so many Microsoft products all the time. But the tablet PC I was excited to be able to include just because it's something that seems to push us towards a new future, connecting the physical to the software world. Yeah.
How do you deal with cost and schedule pressures?
I think, you know, that little bit about the sort of quick prototyping is probably the simple answer. I mean, if I look at why I think IDEO has been successful, I think that rapid prototyping concept is an answer not just to the business design dilemma, but also to the dilemma of cost and schedule. And of course, being a consulting company at IDEO, we always have the discipline of our clients' pressure. You know, that we can have a fairly loose-seeming culture because really the discipline is provided by the cost and schedule limitations of each project driven by the business of our clients. So they're always there. But at the same time, I think the rapid prototyping is the simple answer to an approach, at least. Yeah.
Have you ever been grossly wrong about something? Like looked at something and you first thought that it'll never work and then it's a big hit?
I think the whole idea of the rapid prototyping is that it gives you a chance to be wrong a lot of the time. You know, David Kelly used to have a little slogan which was fail frequently to succeed sooner, because you find out what might be wrong and then you can mend it and move forward. If you talk about the things which are sort of surprises in terms of the development of new technologies, I certainly felt a bit left out by the internet. You know, that I didn't realize the internet was coming until it came, in terms of its sudden takeoff, that is. So in that sense, I suppose that's a different kind of wrongness in terms of not preconceiving its likelihood. Yeah.
Have you come across any methods or techniques when you have lots of cooks in the kitchen? So in a lot of these examples, you have visionaries who really were the driving force behind it. I was wondering, when you have a lot of visionaries in the room, what do you do in order to come up with an optimal solution?
Well, actually, that is the secret to our process, and I think it's the secret to a lot of products or problem sets, contexts where there's some complexity in the issues. And we have multidisciplinary teams all the time now, and so the idea of individual authorship really does fade away. And we think of looking for what we call T-shaped people. You know, people who are not just good at one particular thing, like the artist, but also interested in collaboration. So I think, you know, we've been putting sort of cross-disciplinary teams in on projects for enough years now that they seem to have got the hang of forgetting about their individual contribution. So that when we say, check your disciplines at the door, you know, you move into a project room to work in a team, and you're not really worried about who comes up with which idea. And really, you're thinking of the shared mind being more powerful than the individual mind. And then, you know, the nature of the personality which is interested in that kind of collaboration is an essential prerequisite. But also a bit of practice, I think, gets people to enjoy that and feel that there is more to what they can do collectively than what they can do individually. And any complex set of problems, I think that's essential today. I mean, if you look at design and the kind of traditional vision of design that the world has of the guru designer who does the beautiful glass, you know, that's still absolutely possible, but it's only when the glass is a simple enough problem that a single individual can deal with it. Whereas if you look at something like systemic, or something like the cell phones in that level of complexity, there's just no way that an individual can get their head around it. So you have to work together. But the secret, I think, of working together is really believing that you can forget your individual ego and have an ego which is shared. Yeah.
Comment you made about what Terry Winograd was saying about having difficulty getting people into his lab at Stanford, but now through testing at Google, he's got millions of people per day. It seems to me that remote observation, you might miss a lot about what that user's intention was or what they were inferring or why they went someplace.
Yes.
Can you recommend ways to avoid deducting the wrong conclusions from remote testing where there isn't like an observer or participant?
Well, it seems to me it's rather like the difference between the market research techniques and the innovation research techniques. That if you want to find out something about something that doesn't yet exist, then those kinds of explicit response methods don't work, whether they're online or not online. Whereas if you're actually trying to test a prototype, you've got something already built, and you want to try it out, then it works fine. But that's the same kind of difference as, you know, going to market research with a number of physical prototypes for an object. But it's just speeded up by the online process. But I do think the important distinction in my mind is the difference between something that's a latent need that's not realized as a solution yet versus something which is already a version of something which you can ask people about. Yeah.
I think I saw a video with Kelly and how they went about designing a actual grocery store shopping cart, and they broke into teams, and the teams would come back and present the idea, and the best one was the one that was chosen as the solution. What do you think about that design process where teams are broken into, they're broken into teams and they compete and for the best idea? I don't think we do that here quite a lot. Can you speak to that?
Well, I think to me it's the structure of the team that matters most. You know, the ABC Nightline video that you're talking about was an artificial project set up in order to be entertaining TV. And so the nature of the team structure was typical of what we do. But I don't believe the competitive nature of the alternatives was typical. That's pretty expensive, actually. And then we did that again with another TV program called CBS Sunday Morning, which was designing the ultimate cubicle for Dilbert. And there we had several different alternatives. Now, in the brainstorming level, where you're just trying to get a large range of ideas, well, sure, three teams are better than one. I mean, you're more likely to get diversity and and richness, aren't you? So I think if you have a kind of the opportunity, a budget or a structure which allows you to have multiple teams, then they can produce a wider range of ideas, which is great. And that's the same kind of difference as a brainstorm versus a single person. It just, to me, is just, you know, we'll see more ideas if we use those techniques. If you take a practical and realistic development process, there's an importance about knowledge of the details, which starts to happen very soon. I mean, not really at the beginning. I mean, I think you can brainstorm quite wildly to begin with, very productively, but as soon as you're getting past those first stages in the second or third loop of prototyping, then to have a more dedicated team who really understand the context more richly is usually more productive.
Maybe two more questions.
This may be addressed in your book, but I was wondering whether you've noticed in your experience, in your career, whether there are certain patterns that are reproducible in design, that result in good design, and whether there's almost a framework of good patterns that ultimately lead to reproducible, high-quality designs.
Well, it's hard for me to tell that, really. I mean, I think most of the differences between good and bad are so subtle. It seems to me that one of the advantages of the design thinking approach is that we harness the subconscious. You know, I use the analogy of an iceberg, that if you think of your conscious mind, this the little bit that sticks above the water, and there's this huge lump of ice underneath that nobody can see, which is your subconscious mind. And if you take any of the arts, they tend to use that whole process. They don't know how they do it, therefore. Implicitly, you know, because it's explicit above the water and implicit below, it's tacit knowledge, and therefore people are not articulate about what those patterns may be. So I think you can describe a process successfully, and you can say, well, this process seems to work pretty well, therefore shall we go on doing it? But to say that it's a recognizable pattern when it's in this fuzzy land of the subconscious is something that probably is very difficult to achieve. One more? Yeah.
Question about, in general, what do you think about the involvement of clients in decision-making processes? It's like in design, sometimes we're ingrained to like present three designs, and versus the sort of more expert approach where you sort of recommend this design and sort of back it up with it.
I think the most productive thing is when you involve the people all the way through. And if you sort of think of the client design team relationship as being we all work together and then we show you this, then it tends to lead to artificiality, a little bit dangerous perhaps. You might be giving them the wrong set of alternatives, or they might be evaluating the alternatives in a way that wasn't cognizant of the context. So it seems the more productive is to get them involved all the way through. We have a sort of explicit technique called participatory design, where you structure that in a way where the decision takers are actually part of the process. And I think it's lovely when they feel they own it because of that. And the more you can achieve that kind of integration between decision taker and design team, the better, in my view. Thanks.